comforter, teacher, and our guide. Is there a glad worshiper in the house this morning? Is there a happy worshiper in the house this morning? Is there somebody who's thankful to be alive in the house this morning? Good morning to you, my brother, my sister. Good morning, Holy Spirit. Good morning, brother and sister. The Bible teaches us to make a joyful shout unto God, all the earth. Sing out the honor of his holy name. Make his praise glorious. Somebody ought to praise him this morning. Say unto God, how awesome are your works. Through the greatness of your power, your enemies shall submit to the Lord. Oh, my brother, my sister, I don't mind praising him this morning because he's been good. Has the Lord been good to you? You ought to give him some praise. Did the Lord bring you out? You ought to give him some praise. If the Lord lifted you up, you ought to give him some praise. If you're able, you ought to rest on your feet and give him some praise. Make a joyful noise.
If you would remain standing as we move further into our services, I want to thank the pastor for setting stage, making it worthy of worship. At this time, we will have a selection by the music minister, and after that, we'll have our scripture by Deacon Hubert Thurman and invocation by Deacon Earl Quiller. And then we'll go back to the music again in that manner. Y'all have to excuse me, because I'm as happy as anybody in here. I just can't stand as much as y'all as you can. Amen.
Everybody clap your hand this morning. We came to praise him because he's worthy this morning. Woke us up on due time. And we got it. That's enough to say thank you, Jesus.
Praise him, my Lord. Praise him.
standing at the 22nd to the 26th verse. I need you all to pray for me this morning. You'll have it. Thank you. Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went unto the desert of Syria. For 3 days they were traveling in the desert without finding any water. When they came to Mush, they could not drink it because the water was bitter. That is why it's called Mush. So the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "What are we to drink?" Then Moses cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, show him a piece of wood." He threw it into the water, and the water became sweet. There the Lord made a decision on the law of them, and there he tests them. He said, "If you listen carefully to the voice of the Lord, your God, and do what is right in his eyes, if you pay attention to his command and keep all of his decrees, I would not bring on you any disease, brought on you in Egypt, for I am the Lord who heal you." That's God's word for God's people. May God add a blessing to the readers of his word.
Amen.
The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler, the horn of my salvation, and my high tower. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy. To be praised.
Yes,
praise him.
Praise him.
Our Father, our Maker, and our Creator. Praise him. The one who brought us from our mother's womb, protected us every day of our life, brought us through yesterday. We trust you, God, with today and have hope in you for tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
Praise him.
Praise
the one who has the power over life and death, who woke us up this morning, touched us with a finger of love. We was enclosed in our right mind, found the blood still running warm in our veins, had an appetite this morning. People called our name and we responded.
Yeah.
We praise him.
Praise.
You alone are worthy, God.
Worthy.
For everything that we have, everything that we are, is because of you.
Yes,
now, Father,
yes,
we ask,
yes,
that your spirit reigns and rules in the midst of these services today.
Yeah.
We pray, Father God, that every word that is spoken, every song that is sang, every prayer that is uttered, every praise that is lifted, everything that is doing in this place is to your honor and for your glory. Let us be for real and not for show. Father God, we pray for our children. We ask, God, and we first say thank you, God, for allowing them to make it to this point in the school year. And we pray, Father God, that as the school year comes to a close, that you look over them as we go into the summer months, Father. Be with our children. When they are out of our sight and out of our reach, we pray that you are with them.
Please,
we lift up, Father, our communities right now. There are all manners of issues and problems, Father.
Jesus.
We ask that you regulate minds and hearts. Let us know that violence isn't the answer. Let us know that you are in control of our emotions. Help us and give us wisdom, God, and clarity of mind so that we think and do the right things, Father. And most importantly, in our communities, help us to love one another.
Help us.
We pray, Father God, for each family and each household. We pray, Father God, that we can live the way that we're supposed to live in private. So that your spirit can be manifested in public. Now, God, as we get ready to go through the midst of these services today, we ask that you lay aside everything that would be a weight that would prevent us from hearing from you. And we pray, God, that you open up our hearts and our minds so that we can receive your word and as a result be better because of it. These and other blessings we ask for in the name of your son, Jesus Christ. And we say amen.
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 And amen.
Amen.
Put food on our tables and clothes on our backs. I got an airdrop on the Sunday school this morning. The question was, I said, what is the Holy Ghost? It's not a it. Came to tell you this morning that it is a source of life. It'll get in me and it'll get in you. Make us love one another. Make us love our enemies and our friends. Put your hands together. We came to praise him this morning because he's worthy to be praised. It was early one morning, just about the break of day. Jesus came and he touched me and he wiped my tears away. Started running, I started shouting, couldn't find no time to doubt him. Oh, I
touch the Holy Ghost.
Yeah. Let me say that one time. It was early one morning, just about the break of day. Jesus came in that operating room and he wiped my tears away. Wanted to run, I wanted to shout. I didn't have no time to doubt. Oh, woo! Yeah, yeah. Oh, the Holy Ghost, save me. Holy Ghost, set me free. Holy Ghost, change my life. Holy Ghost, brought me out. You know I, woo! Come on, church, we came to praise him. Holy Ghost, save me. Holy Ghost, set me free. Holy Ghost, change my life. Holy Ghost, brought me out. You know I, yeah, yeah, oh, it was a hope. Said it, keep on. I'm talking about the Holy Ghost. Said it, keep on. It'll make you wanna walk right. Make you wanna talk right. Make you wanna love your enemies. Make you wanna love your friends. Said it, keep on moving. Keep on moving. Said it, keep on moving. Keep on moving. Oh, the Holy Ghost, woo! I said he keep on. I'm talking about the Holy Ghost. It keep on. I'm like Jeremiah. Jeremiah did say. Jeremiah said, just like fire shut up in my bones. Came to tell you today, it won't leave me alone. I said it keep on moving. It keep on moving. It keep on moving. It keep on moving. Oh, the Holy Ghost.
This is a good time to have the financial appeal. You can tell how real your shouts really are, because it takes our finance to really make things move as well. So Deacon Cunningham is going to come with that, and I'll make my way back to my seat, and I'll stay there unless I'm asked to get up again.
Good morning, church. My favorite scripture, one of my favorite scriptures, says that, out of the book of Corinthians, says, when I was a child, I thought as a child. I understood as a child. I spoke as a child. But the end of it says, when I became a man, I put away childish things. Yes, and I say that in this offertorial period because when I was a child, I thought that when I gave money to the church, it went to the pastor. I did. Granddaddy gave you that quarter, I put it in my pocket. But as a man, I realized that giving is one of God's responsibilities that we must give because God first gave as well. That there are communities that need help, and it's our responsibility to help. So with that being said, let us go to prayer. Heavenly Father, we come this morning with a bowed head, grateful and humble, just because you're God all by yourself, that you didn't have to allow us to wake up this morning, but you saw fit to allow us one more day. So dear God, we thank you for being God and being God all by yourself. So, dear God, we pray for those who gave this morning. We pray for those who really, really wanted to give, dear God, and they just did not have. But as well, we pray for that soul who's holding on to that money as if it is their God. I pray for them, dear God. I pray that whatever be collected be used to build up your kingdom. There are hungry people, dear God. There are families that are bereaved, dear God. There are lives that are torn asunder. And all we can do is help, dear Lord. We thank you. We love you. Amen.
Let the church say amen. Amen. If you're glad to be alive, say amen again. If you want to just give God thanks, why don't you say amen and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. I know some folk came in, I don't feel like praising, I don't feel like worshiping, I just came here to get my little word and go on back to the house. But because you are alive and in your right mind, that's reason enough to give the Lord some praise. But can I also tell somebody that worship is not predicated upon how I feel? Yeah. Lord, help me right there. Yes, it's not about how I feel about worship. It's the fact that God has allowed me to be able to worship. Yeah. Amen. See, there was a time when I didn't have worship on my mind on a Sunday morning. I must be the only one. Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy. But can I tell you, it is important that we recognize that God is the one who allows us. We didn't buy it, we couldn't earn it, but God allows us by his grace and his mercy to be able to answer to our own names again. Amen. I have to throw in that again because he did it yesterday. He did it last week. He did it last month. And oh, I'm so glad that in my bedroom, he said, Griffin, it's time to get up. Hallelujah. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white. All are precious in his sight. Let me ask our children to come on down. Amen. Now this morning we need y'all to spread out a little bit. Amen. Spread out a little bit. Amen. Go down a little bit further. Go down a little bit further. There you go. There you go. Look at that. Look at that. Amen. Amen. When you receive your paper, I want you to put it down on the floor. Amen. Put it down on the floor. All right, put it on the floor. Amen. Now, everybody, turn around and face the congregation. Turn around. Face the congregation. Amen. Amen. There you go. Turn around and look back that way. There you go. There you go. There you go. Amen. Don't look at me. Don't look at me. Look at the congregation. Don't look at me. Don't look at me. Just listen. Listen. I need everybody to look at the carpet. Where's the carpet? Look at the carpet. Keep looking at the carpet. Keep looking at the carpet. As you are looking at the carpet, can you see what's on the screen? Oh, look at the carpet. Look at the carpet. Can you see what's on the screen? Say it loud. All right. While you're looking at the carpet, can you see what's on the ceiling? Oh, my goodness. Well, turn around and face me. Keep looking down. Keep looking down. And you see the picture, right? You don't see the picture? Hallelujah. That's why you have to prepare for live stream. Amen. Amen. Keep looking at the paper on the carpet. Keep looking at the paper on the carpet. Now, I need everybody, as you see the man on the mountain, stretch your arms like his. Can you stretch your arms? Thank you. Thank you. Now I need you to look up at the ceiling. Amen. In Psalm 121, that's on your paper, it says, I will lift up. Will you repeat after me? I will lift up my eyes to the hills from which my help comes. That's because when we pray, we can look up to God for help. Amen? So when you have hard things come before you, when something very hard happens in your life, you can look a little bit louder. When hard things come into your life, you can look. Amen. Because our help comes from God, who is high and above. Amen. So as you come to the close of the school year, I know some hard lessons are coming, right? Because they want you to remember everything from August till now. Amen. But as you're going through those hard things, as you're doing those hard things, I want you to be able to not look at the ground, but to look. And God will give you help when you pray. Amen. You can say, Lord, repeat after me, Lord, I sure enough need your help. Come on now. We got to say it with some, okay, ready? Lord, I sure enough need your help. Grab your paper and you may return to your seat. I don't know about y'all, but that's the best part of worship for me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank the Lord for his grace and mercy, and we thank him for our children. Would you show some love for our children one more time? Couple of things we want to share, and we'll be out of your way, but we do want to congratulate our newest developing daring disciples. Amen. Yesterday we observed the ordinance of baptism, and as I call your name, would you come and receive your certificate of baptism? We have four on yesterday. Ms. Portia Latrice Johnson. Amen. Mr. Russell J. Johnson. Mr. Sean D. Johnson. And Miss Tia Janae Beard. Amen. just for the record, it doesn't take us long to fill up the pool. Amen. Our A1 awesome, amazing, superb, stupendous, splendid audio visual team. Y'all supposed to be clapping right about there. They've done a tremendous job. They've done a tremendous job and do so each and every Sunday, each and every worship experience. But they've been working to test our social media capabilities and overcoming broadband challenges that limit us in many ways. They've been able to help us provide virtual worship on the church's Facebook page as well as recordings on YouTube. Amen. I'm sharing that because we're continuing to do that each Sunday morning, and we need your continued assistance and support as you like and comment and share the video and share it with others. That's going to help us to reach folks that don't come in person. I've been sharing with and studying with Dr. Brianna Parker, who did her Doctor of Ministry research as well as has done extended research with millennials and in this arena of using social media for worship and ministry. Lately, she's been talking about how we reach college age students and millennials. And she put in her recent webinar this statistic. They've done research with these college age students, and they learned through surveying this group that 41% of those surveyed prefer virtual worship. 41% of those surveyed prefer virtual worship. Why am I saying that? I'm saying that because folks are not coming back in person the way they used to. Amen. Which means that we have to continue to maintain an excellent social media presence so that we can evangelize in that means as well. That we use social media, that we use virtual worship, that we use the technology available to us to reach folk who have already told us they are not coming in person. Don't fuss at them. Don't fuss at them. Tell them to go to the church's Facebook page. Amen. 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 Because one of the reasons we ask the deacons to talk about how folks can give is because some folk who are watching the virtual won't know how to give to Old Macedonia if we don't tell them. Yeah. Amen. 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 And they will give electronically if they know how we can receive it. So we've got to do that as well as maintain our social media presence and our virtual worship and virtual opportunities, because there are some folk who are just not going to dress up and come to the sanctuary. Amen. Amen. I ain't mad with them. I'm going to try to reach them anyway. Amen. Amen. But would you help me thank our social media and audio visual team for the job that they have continued to do? Would you show some more love for them? Please be reminded that our Tuesday noon teaching nuggets and Wednesday in the Word convene each week, Tuesday at noon, Wednesday at 6 p.m., and we are continuing our study. We're closing in on the end of that workbook on the will of God, and certainly invite you to come and help us as we share together. On Thursday, May 18th, we're invited to share with the Zion Fair Missionary Baptist Church in one night of their revival, their spring revival. And we're asking the music ministry to accompany us as I will bring the message and you all will bring the amens, and the music ministry will bring the music. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're also invited as the special guest for the deacon's ordination service at the Macedonia Baptist Church in Martinez, Georgia. They call it the Big M. Amen. I believe the address is 3606 Old Ferry Road. 3606 Old Ferry Road. Pastor Darrell Blocker serves there, and we are delighted to have that invitation to come and share. Today, as we observe the Lord's Supper, we will do so in a different manner because yesterday we encountered spoiled supply. Amen. And we certainly didn't want to observe the Lord's Supper with spoiled supply. So today we'll observe the Lord's Supper a little bit different. Our leaders have met. We've collectively decided on a course of action, and we ask you to be patient with us and to cooperate with us as we observe the Lord's Supper. The ushers are already alerted to assist us. The deacons are alerted to assist us, and we will observe this ordinance. Amen. We thank the Lord for the ability to adjust. Amen. Amen. Finally, this week, the Baptist E&M Convention of South Carolina convenes at the Sheraton Myrtle Beach through the end of this week, and we are traveling there for the convention. As made known previously, I am a candidate for vice president at large on the ticket with Dr. Jamie Graham. This week will be official for all candidates to be known to the convention, and then election will take place in 2024. So we're asking for your prayers. It's a challenge when you're trying to do the Lord's work in the midst of politics. Lord, have mercy. But we ask for your prayers with us and for us, not only for traveling mercies, but that the Lord will get the glory. Amen. Amen. After our music ministry, we will come back with what the Lord has given for this first Sunday in May. Amen.
Pastor, I'm going to do like you now. I'm going to raise my hand and look up towards heaven because I need help. I can't speak for you, but I know and realize that I need help. If Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. Oh, my Lord. If Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. Oh, Lord. Come on and help me, choir. Oh, if Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. My Lord, oh, if Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. Oh, yeah, nobody can. Let me say this right here. There was a woman with an issue of blood. The Bible said 12 long years. She heard about Jesus passing by, and she pressed away through the crowd. She said, if I could touch the hem of his garment. Oh, I know I'll be made whole. If Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. Oh, Lord, listen. Oh, if Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. Oh, if Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. Oh, Lord. I got one more thing. Listen. Someone is struggling today, and all your bills are due. Your child is giving you problems, and your health is failing too. The weight of the world pressing you down. And when you need a friend, no one can be found. But I know someone that really cares. Whatever the situation, God can answer prayer. Oh, if Jesus, nobody can. My Lord, nobody can. Whoa, if Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. Oh, my Lord. Whoa, if Jesus can't fix it, nobody can. Yeah, nobody can.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Would you bow your heads with me in a word of prayer? Lord, we need you, and we can't get along without you. There's so many ways that you have blessed, so many ways you have supplied, but yet each and every day we find ourselves once again needing your help, aid, and assistance. No matter how many times I stand in this preaching place, I still need you. No matter how many times I'm afforded the privilege to proclaim your word, I can't do it without you. I need you to stand in my body. I need you to think with my mind. I need you to speak through my lips. I need you to tie my tongue to your truths. Lord, I pray that you would anoint afresh not only my mouth to speak your truths, but you would anoint our ears, hearts, and hands and feet, that we would hear and that we would be obedient to your word, your will, and your way. Forgive us of our sins, O God. Forgive us of our wrongs, our shortcomings. Forgive us for leaving things undone you told us to do and doing things that you told us not to do. And as we worship today, speak to our hearts. Speak to our struggles. Speak to our sickness. Speak to our sinful ways. And cause us to get right with you. How we thank you for your grace, your mercy, your love, your forgiveness, and certainly for your son. Now, God, have your way. Move Griffin from Griffin as far as the east is from the west, and allow us to see and hear more of thee and less of me. In Jesus' strong, matchless, marvelous, and amazing name we pray. And all of God's people said amen. Again, we give glory, honor, praise to the name of our God. For the scripture declares that at the name of Jesus, every knee must bow, every tongue must confess that Jesus is Lord. We give honor to Pastor Emeritus Myers. And would you, one more time, just show some love for Pastor Emeritus. How we love him and appreciate him so very, very much. to our associate ministers and to all of our officers, to all of you. It's good to be in this worship experience, in this place again today. Amen. I dare not take for granted any breath the Lord allows me to breathe and any opportunity the Lord allows me to enjoy. I give him thanks. Amen. Would you stand with me for the reading of God's word again? From Exodus, the 15th chapter, we're in the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, chapter number 15, verse 22 through 26. Let me thank Deacon Thurman. I know there were some challenging words in this text. Amen. Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went to the desert of Shur. They traveled into the desert for 3 days and did not find any water. When they came to Marah, they could not drink the water at Marah because it was bitter. That is why it's called Marah. Then the people complained against Moses. "What are we to drink?" Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, which he threw into the water, and the water became sweet. There the Lord presented to them a statute and an ordinance, and there he tested them. "God is speaking," he said. "If you will carefully obey the Lord your God, do what is right in his eyes, listen to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, then I won't inflict on you all the diseases that I inflicted on the Egyptians, because I am the Lord your healer." I am the Lord your healer. And that's what I want to talk about today. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord our healer, God our healer. I need some audience participation this morning. So if you would repeat after me, "My struggles remain real. And my God supplies strength and helps me through my real struggles." If you meant that, you ought to give the Lord some praise. God is a healer. God is a healer. I know sometimes it's a struggle to hear that and believe that, but I am a witness that the Lord heals whom he chooses to heal, even when we don't deserve God's attention. God's mercy, God's love, God's presence, or God's healing for my hurts show up whether I deserve it or not. Yet God doesn't require that I measure up to perfection in order for God to heal. Somebody ought to have a shout cue right there that you and I don't have to be perfect in order for God to heal our bodies. May I hasten to add, my brother and my sister, that sometimes God's version of healing does not add up to how we expect God to heal. Sometimes God chooses to heal by removing somebody from their suffering. Sometimes God removes a person from their sickness or removes a person from their strife or their struggle in order to heal their situation. But God is still a healer. In our Baptist doctrine, we learned in our articles of faith this second article, which reads, "We believe the scriptures teach that there is one and only one living and true God. And God is an infinite, intelligent spirit whose name is Jehovah." That is an excerpt from our second article of faith, and it teaches us that God possesses multiple characteristics. The Hebrew people understood and realized that God has revealed so much of God's person that they needed to use different words and different ways in order to describe all of the deeds, all of the personality, all of the attributes, all of the characteristics, and all of the things that made God, God. God is too vast to be described by one word only. God is too powerful for one word to encompass all that God is. God is too much God for one word to describe God's godness, because one word just ain't enough. I'm reminded right here of the late great actor and South Carolina native, Mr. Chadwick Boseman. Surely you recognize that name. He played the role of the Black Panther. In the movie Black Panther, the late Mr. Boseman played the role of a superhero. He did so as the first African-American, the first Black actor in a major motion picture to be the superhero. Once or twice in the original Black Panther movie, you can remember this line if you watch the movie. He says, "I am your king." In fact, the line is used in the advertisement for the movie. And if you watch the film, you know at the climax that King T'Challa defeats his nemesis, Killmonger, in a classic hand-to-hand combat with 21st century technology. King T'Challa's action of fighting for and winning back his rightful place at the throne as King of Wakanda earns him royal respect, deserving of a king. So much so that he no longer has to shout, "I am your king," because he's demonstrated his kingship. He shows by his actions he has embodied the characteristics and the attributes of one who is deserving of the title of king. But we are not in Wakanda. And we are not dealing with a nemesis like Killmonger. We've got a nemesis named the devil, the evil one. And we've got a king that's over all other kings. Can I tell somebody in worship today that we have a more excellent king? We have a greater than great king. We have a king who outkings all other kings, because he's King of Kings. He's Lord of Lords. He's God of Gods, because he is our creator. And the Bible just told you and me that our God is not only King of Kings, but our God is a healer. The God of God shows these Hebrew children his godness by the personification of his role as Jehovah Rapha. God makes plain the message that he is the God who is a healer. I need to rewind and play that again because somebody needs to make sure that you record it appropriately in your heart and mind, that our God shows that he is the embodiment, the personification of Jehovah Rapha, because our God is a healer. Walk with me as we enter into the world of the Hebrew people, as led by this first biblical prophetic voice named Moses. Moses, in this peek into the brief snippet of Hebrew history, shows us that God cares enough to heal. Yes, my brothers and my sisters, we've heard it all before. Love is what love does. Say it again. Love is what love does. If you really love somebody, you don't just say it. As I learned a long time ago, talk is cheap. A whole lot of folk can talk about love, but it takes some action to go with it to demonstrate love. And God has demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, the Lord sent his son to save us. We learn in this text that God heals by his virtue, and he heals in this preaching passage. It may prove difficult for some folk today to envision a God of healing in a world so filled with hatred. Just yesterday, hatred showed up in Allen, Texas. Just a few weeks ago, hatred showed up and gunned down folk in public spaces. Just a little while ago, as a matter of fact, the report is that we've had 199 mass shootings of four or more people in the incident. Hatred is on the rise. But God is still a healer. The narrative does not begin with the Israelites in the desert of Shur. This biblical story actually had its beginning in Egypt while the Hebrews remained shackled in a slave-supported economy. That is, this narrative contains the story of an oppressor enslaving a people. Got to say it again. We are studying today. We are dealing with, in this preaching passage, a fact that there is an oppressor enslaving a people. Okay, I got to say this way. The people were not slaves. They were a people who became enslaved. There's a difference. You don't come out of the womb of your mama a slave. You are born into an enslaving circumstance. Because there are oppressors everywhere. There are people in oppressive cultures in order to maintain their profit. Ooh, Jesus. There are some folks in oppressive moments in their leadership who think it's their job to make profit on the backs of others. The Israelites have done the work, and the Egyptians are reaping all the benefits. The enslaved worked from can't see to can't see. And the enslaver welcomed every benefit, every blessing, and all of the bounty. Ah, that sounds kind of familiar. Sounds kind of familiar. I wasn't born then, but I discovered that that's been the plight of black and brown people in America since America became America. For centuries, our people worked lands they could not own. Our ancestors harvested crops from which they could not reap the benefit.
our mothers, sisters, aunties, grandmothers, daughters, clean houses in which we could not crash, cook food from which we received the scraps, wash clothes we could never wear, earn money or make profits for the oppressor that we could not save, could not spend, and could not share. And as political commentator and attorney Angela Rye would put it, we built this joint for free. Don't miss the fact. These latest discriminatory and racist tactics we are seeing today, it's not new. Deacon Newsom, it's not new. They've been doing this stuff a long time. We've seen all of this before. That's part of the reason some folk don't want to teach all of history. They know that they borrowed tactics from the grandfather, from the grandmother, the great-grandfather, the great-grandmother, and their aunties, and they even had a lunch while they watched our folk being lynched. Pharaoh is doing the same thing in the text. But Adolf Hitler did it too. Benito Mussolini did it too. Dictators and oppressors use the same tactics, but they update their tools for the current times. They don't have to do it the way Mussolini did it back then. Now they can use technology. Let me show you. Yes, last week we were doing our exercise in the morning. And got finished doing our exercise. I turned on YouTube and I selected a playlist that I wanted to hear to set the atmosphere for worship in my house. And songs started playing, and then between songs, because I decided I wasn't gonna pay them extra for a subscription, I had to endure a commercial. Played one commercial, and then the next commercial played, and it was a person who says he's not yet a candidate for president, but his advertisement says his name, not going to pronounce it, his name for president 2024. I said, wait a minute, something's wrong with this picture. You said you're not a candidate. But somebody paid the fee for you to interrupt my praise. How is it that one can pay for an advertisement to promote a false statement in America today? I got the answer. Oppressors and the privileged have always gotten away with making up the rules in the middle of the game so that you and I can be dispossessed of what God gave us. Hebrew, let me get back on track, because somebody's wondering, how does this relate to water being bitter? After exiting the Red Sea, verse 22 points out that the Hebrews traveled 3 days. Somebody say 3 days. They traveled 3 days in the desert toward Shur. That may not mean much, but can I tell you, when you look at history, you will discover that Shur is a wilderness. Lord, help me right here. It's a wilderness in the northwest part of Sinai. It is south of the Mediterranean coastline, and it's rugged, it's vast, and it's sparsely populated because it's a wilderness. They're in the desert, and they've traveled 3 days with no water. Somebody who knows something about water knows that you got to have water within 3 to 4 days as a human being in order to live. But the water they encounter is bitter. It's bitter, but the water description as bitter is less important to me than is the fact that the people have become bitter. How do you know, preacher? They complaining.
They're in the desert. They've been traveling 3 days. They've depleted their water supply. And I believe panic has shown up, and panic has caused the people to become bitter because they know they need water in order to live. Did you know that water has multiple benefits? Water is vital. Water helps digestion. Water regulates sweating and respiration. Water delivers oxygen all over the body. Water flushes the body waste of the inner system. Water lubricates our joints. Water fosters growth and reproduction. Water causes survival in every cell of the body. Water acts as a shock absorber for the brain and the spinal cord. All I'm trying to tell you is we gotta drink more water. I gotta get out of here, but can I tell somebody that where they are is because they asked to be there? Jesus. They requested in the backdrop of the lesson to go into the wilderness because they wanted to go into the wilderness to worship. Sometimes you got to get away from folk and worship the Lord by yourself. Sometimes you got to shut out the world, put down the phone, get rid of the device, cut off the television, leave folk alone, and get to an alone place so you and the Lord can commune with one another. And can I give you this friendly advice? Don't do all the talking. Let the Lord talk to you and you listen to him. Can I tell you, my brothers and my sisters, they are where they are. They are in that location as a result of being led by God through Moses. They were led by God through Moses to be in the wilderness. One more time. They were led by God through Moses to land at a location called the wilderness. They complained to Moses about their location, and they complained to Moses about this position he has put them in. They complained to Moses about the conditions of having no water except some bitter water available to them. They are complaining, and I need to tell somebody that complaining did not stop in the wilderness. Y'all make sure security has got me covered, because there are some folk who complain in the camp. They complain that they did not want to die in the desert. They complain that they did not want to become extinct in this exodus. But complaining did not die in the desert. Complaining did not become extinct at this exodus. Complaining has traveled through the annals of time. And right here in 2023, if the air conditioning is on, it's too cold. If the heat is on, it's too hot. If it's raining outside, it's too wet. If the sun is shining, it's too bright. If the wind is blowing, it's too windy. If the sanctuary is full, it's too many folk up in here. If the sanctuary is empty, people ought to show up at church. No matter how good things might be, somebody will find something to complain about. And if the preacher preached too long, the reason they could find space to complain, Pastor Emeritus Myers, is because I believe they are engaging in selective amnesia. They have forgotten how powerful the Lord has moved in their life. Yes, they've forgotten how many monumental miracles God has operated before their eyes. They feel justified in complaining to Moses, but somebody is wondering, what have they forgotten?
They've forgotten that God led them by a pillar of fire by night and led them by a pillar of cloud by day. They've forgotten that God fostered their liberation. They've forgotten that God spoke through Moses with pontification. They've forgotten that Moses spoke prophetically with predictions and proclamations. They've forgotten that God worked through supernatural power to bring about a manifestation. They've forgotten that God used divine orchestration and sent 10 plagues in which the people of Israel survived and people in Egypt had to die. I'm compelled to deal with selective amnesia because there's some folk in 2023 who've forgotten how good the Lord has been to you. How could I forget that the Lord brought me through the pandemic? How could I forget? The Lord kept food on the table when we couldn't even stay in the grocery store long. God kept on providing, saw me through my struggles, delivered me from my sadness, lifted me out of my situations, liberated me from self-imposed seclusion, shown miracles in my life, demonstrated power in my circumstance. God, I say God has been good. A healer in my mess. He's been a healer in my craziness. He's been a healer in my calamities. God, I say God has done so much for me. Is there a witness in the house? You struggled, but God showed up. You were sad, and he made you glad. He showed up, supplied what you needed when you needed it most. Somebody ought to remember, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I would be. That's why I get a case of the can't help it. I can't help but praise his name. I can't help but give him glory. I can't help but magnify his name. And every now and again, I have to shout, yep, yeah, he's been good. He is a healer. He healed my money problem. He healed my body problem. He healed my mind problem. He healed my social problem. Because God is a healer. Do I have a witness? Has he worked it out for you? If he has, you ought to wave your hand. You ought to throw your head back and shout hallelujah. My God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. I gotta go there. Jesus is my rock. Jesus is my redeemer. Jesus is the rose of Sharon. Jesus is my savior. He died, but he didn't stay dead early. Since I'm Baptist, I can't say it just once. Early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand. Shout, yep,
Shout, yeah! He healed. He heals. He heals. He heals. Moses, grab the branch, throw it in the water. Rewind, try it again. Moses, grab the branch, throw it in the water. Moses, grab the branch and throw it in the water. You notice the branch has no healing power. But because of Moses' obedience, God says, I got to keep my word to take care of you in the wilderness. Since you were obedient to me to go when I said go and to stay in the wilderness until I said move, because you were obedient to me, I'm going to tell you what to do. Grab the branch, throw it in the water, and the water turned from bitter to sweet. God can change. God can heal your situation and turn it from bitter and make it sweet, so that when you get on the other side, you can come out with a praise. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yeah. My brother, my sister, God is a healer. God is a healer. God is a healer. I know it may look dark, it may look deadly, but God is still in control. God is still on the throne. God is still ordering steps. God is still healing situations. And I'm here to let you know he can do the same for you. God is no respecter of persons. Whatever he's already done, God maintains the ability to do it. Because God, watch this, God outkings all kings. There is no king like our God. And so my brother, my sister, if you're here today and you're ready to turn your life over to the Lord, you're ready to be healed of your sin sickness, I'm here to diagnose your situation. You are sin sick until you meet the doctor of all doctors, and his name is Jesus. You need Jesus to heal your sin sickness today.
Sometimes life will hurt you, but remember God heals.
God is a healer.
God is a healer.
Yes, he is.
Sometimes weapons form against you, but they'll never prosper. Remember, God is your shield.
He's waiting for your call.
He is waiting for your call. Waiting to shield you from your fall.
And there's a place of rest.
Thank you for joining us today at Old Macedonia Baptist Church. We believe giving is a natural response for believers of Jesus Christ. We receive God's love and grace, and out of an overflow of a grateful heart, we give. We have multiple ways you can give. You can mail or drop off your tithes and offerings to 200 Macedonia Road, North Augusta, South Carolina, 29860. You can give using the online giving feature on our website at www.oldmacedoniabc.org. Or you can download the Givelify app to your mobile device. search for Old Macedonia Baptist Church in North Augusta, South Carolina. And don't forget to mark it as a favorite. To whom much is given, much is required. God bless.